We are now entering a study cycle meet on Indian accounting standards. And who best than CA would be Vikram to take us through the next 2 hours in the topic which is relevant to us. A little note about the speaker. CA would be Vikram is a member of the institute, NCA, and also is licensed of ICSI. His partner in Sudeshan Company, the firm of chartered accountants, which is in practice for the last 50 years. Brings in the demonstrative history of working in the audit and assurance industry. This area of presentation includes statutory audit, Ind AS, IFRS, the US GAAP reporting, and consultancy on financial reporting, risk management, internal controls reviews, business process. He brings knowledge, experience, and expertise with proficiency and fitness. Through a professional career span of 12 plus years, he has led various prestigious assurance and advisory engagements for some large and marquee clients in the IT and ITS, financial services, manufacturing, textiles, retail, education, and real estate sectors with an added experience and exposure for entities listed in the Stock Exchange of India. He has worked extensively with multinational corporations and Indian groups, is an experienced auditor with extensive experience of reporting to board, audit committees, and interacting with senior management. With a passion for newer and challenging opportunities, he is instrumental in firms foray into consulting advice services and in India's reporting, financial controls, reviews, etc. He can be reached at vikram.u@sureshanpuru.com. With these brief words, I request the chairman of the branch to briefly to introduce the speaker and give the forward booking.
Thanks, study circle. It's happening since many years. Now we open it up to our students also. So student faculty can join the study circle meet free of charge. It is free for all the students. I request members to take the benefits and making a learning session every Wednesday evening for all their students. It will help them to learn for their exam also, even for office work. Between that, they will help. In addition to that, Bangalore branch is conducting many other new avenues of practice workshop. So next year, there are two workshops lined up. The first one is transformation of CA to CFO. That is starting from 8th of April to 17th April, 5 days program. The last day, 17th, is going to be a physical meet in a hotel. Remaining 4 days is virtual. Similarly, on 19th April to 24th April, again 5 days of RERA workshop. Again, that the last day, 24th, is going to be a physical meet in a hotel. Remaining all 4 days, virtual meeting. Virtual meeting from evening 4 to 7. So these are all the new avenues that our practicing chartered accountant can look into. Particularly CFO training or a workshop is for practicing chartered accountants. Those who wish to provide CFO service to their clients, good number of SME clients looking for that service, but they are not aware that the chartered accountant can provide such services. With this little training, a chartered accountant can become act out and can act as a CFO, financial officer, chief financial officer role, or a finance manager role. They can play. Virtually or once in a week, once in a 15 days, whatever the mode is convenient for the client, and you make value addition and charge a lump of fees for that. In that way, these are all the additional avenues CS needs to look into, because the government intention is to reduce the compliance. So that is the case, we have to look for these greener areas. So in that way, Bangalore branch is conducting many more new avenues workshop. This first is the beginning. So some more at least I think we have planned another 16 workshops of newer areas of practice. Maximum 2 workshops only we are able to conduct in a month. So in that way, we have planned another 16 in addition to these two. With that, happy learning. Over to speaker.
At the outset, I wish to thank the Institute for giving me an opportunity to be here and share certain thoughts on Indian Accounting Standards, which is known famously as Ind AS. As you all know, Ind AS has been made mandatory for a couple of entities which fall under specific categories, maybe a listed company or an associate or a subsidiary of those listed companies, and public companies whose network has crossed certain limits. Going forward, you would have also seen in the last couple of months, there are a couple of amendments which has happened under ICAR. For ease of understanding, I use the word Ind AS for the Indian Accounting Standards, which is IFRS Converged Accounting Standards. And I'll be using the word ICAR for existing accounting standards, which are applicable across all the entities. Quite a few amendments has happened in ICAR, wherein the whole objective there is to bring ICAR in line with Ind AS. Today, you would have seen Ind AS is applicable for only few companies. Over a period, it has to be made applicable for SMEs also. There is an IFRS, which is internationally accepted IFRS for SMEs. As of now, India do not have any Ind AS for SMEs. It is currently only ICAR. With the objective of transitioning ICAR into Ind AS, there are amendments which has come in ICAR. For example, the best amendment was changing Accounting Standard 6 and bringing Accounting Standard 6 as part of Accounting Standard 10. There was an amendment as far as dividend was concerned. These amendments are actually happening to make ICAR on par with Ind AS. With this background, I would like to take you across a couple of practical issues, practical analysis which we need to do during the course as an auditor or as a finance head of any company. The agenda will be to understand how Ind AS will support the commerce, the recent amendments, and introduction on Ind AS and the practical aspects. What is the overall benefit because of Ind AS for our country? People say because of Ind AS, the work has increased for the finance people, or the financial statements have become more bulkier. But we need to understand how Ind AS is supporting the various commerce and transactions. You would have seen in last year, there were quite a few investments which were happening in India. The best example was Reliance Jio platform, where a good amount of investments happened. Just imagine, during the course of lockdown, if company has to make an investment on any other entity, they require a lot of due diligence. They require lots of audits which has to happen from the investor side. Was it possible otherwise for any company to invest on Indian entities? The whole reason behind such a quick investment which could have happened on Indian entities was mainly because the companies are being following Ind AS, which is nothing but the IFRS which is there outside. Wherever the companies are, wherever the entities are, they are able to understand what our Indian financial statements are. there are very restricted scope or possibilities where financial statements can give any undue informations or misstatements can happen over there. With these principles being covered by Indian entities and which has been consistently audited by the CA firms, for stakeholders, this gives an additional comfort to go ahead and take decisions. If you see overall the way financial statements for Ind AS works, there are three basic principles which governs our Ind AS. One is substance over form, second is fair valuation, and third is the disclosures. Substance over form is one of the biggest change which has happened as far as Ind AS is concerned. Many of us know what exactly substance over form is. Example could be, when we talk from Companies Act, we call as preferential capital. From the Companies Act side, preferential capital is part of equity. But when we get into Ind AS, preferential capital can be broken into two different items. One, the equity portion. Two, the liability portion. We never had option of identifying these differences in the IGAAP time. Today in Ind AS, the whole way in which the financial statements can be looked. In preference share capital, you will have an option to redeem the preference share capital, or you will have an option to convert the preference share capital. Wherever you have an option to redeem, this, the substance over form, that amount is actually a liability. Instead of you taking any amount as a debt, you are taking it as a redeemable preference shares. It does not lead to equity. And wherever you have an option, where rather those preference share capital, where conversion happens, the moment there is a conversion clause and issuer has no control to restrict the conversion, in that such scenario, those items will become equity. That is nothing but the portion which has to get converted into equity share capital. So in our Ind AS, we call it as equity, it's a residual thing. Those items gets broken up based on the substance over form. In Ind AS, we allocate a portion into liability and the other portion goes into equity. That is how our Ind AS works. On the other hand, fair valuation. All of us have seen, we have been talking, Ind AS is more about fair valuation. Is fair when it comes to fixed assets, fair valuation will come into picture. When it comes to borrowings, fair valuation will come into picture. When it comes to financial assets, fair valuation will come into picture. Is it something which is so much different from the IGAAP? If you ask specifically, if you get into the standard specifically, it is not so much different. We had a concept of revaluation in IGAAP 10, which is there in Ind AS. We had a concept of actuarial adjustments under AS 15, which is there in Ind AS employee benefits. We had mark to market. Banks are already using mark to market for the investments, which was used extensively by bankers. Today, that is part of our Ind AS. We use something called fair value through OCI, fair value through PL, or amortized cost. So these are all not something which has come specifically in Ind AS, which was there before, but has been made applicable with a wider sense. It is applicable for various transactions. It is applicable for various items. And the third one, and the most important one in Ind AS, disclosures. If you see entire financial statements, if you can divide, one is the numbers and other is disclosure. In Ind AS, disclosure plays a very important role. Every item, what you have in the financials, the balance sheets, or the statement of changes in equity, or the statement of P&L, every line item will have substantial disclosures. And those disclosures matters. Just to give an example, coming to Ind AS 115, which is on revenue, the quantum of disclosure we have to make. Who are the top customers? How the revenue changes with a change in the foreign exchange earnings, how the revenue changes with segments, all those disclosures we have to mention in the financial statements. What is the overall objective or logic? Stakeholders should understand what can happen to our company. As of 31st March, company has not made good amount of sales. You could have seen many infrastructure companies, their project book would have been open, but revenue is not booked. As a stakeholder, he should not feel lost in the when he reviews the financial statement. If he sees just the financial statement where there is no revenue, he'll not even understand about the future outcome of the company. When you see under Ind AS, there is a specific requirement under Ind AS when we talk about those projects which has not started but which are in the pipeline, or rather which is approved but which will be started over next couple of months. Those disclosures will come in the financial statements. These disclosures help lot of stakeholders to make their decisions and to take decision to analyze the financial numbers. That's one important thing from Ind AS. As you all know, Ind AS was made applicable over two phases. The first phase was made in 2016, wherein they said for all listed companies whose net worth was 500 crore and above, they were liable for Ind AS. Once those companies are liable, all their associate companies, their subsidiaries and their holding entities, which are directly related, will also be made liable for Ind AS. The second phase was from 2017, wherein they said those listed entities which were not part of the phase one will become part of phase two, plus the other companies which were whose network was below 500 crore but above 250 crores and their respective associate subsidiaries and parent companies or holding companies. With this, today all the companies whose network is over and above 250 crores are required to comply with Ind AS. There is no exception. The moment the balance sheet has a net worth of 250 crore and above, you have to comply with Ind AS. The date of transition will be fixed. Date of transition will be the date on which the balance sheet where net worth is crossing 250 crores. Date of transition is very important. That if say for example, as on 31st March 2020, net worth was 250 crore, then 1st April 2020, okay, 31st March 2020 was the balance sheet date. 1st April 2020 will be the date of transition. First year will be the comparatives and second year will be the actual standard moment. The moment there is any Ind AS transition, there will be a lot of adjustments. As I explained in the past slide, fair valuation comes into picture, excessive disclosures will come into picture, and adjustments may have to be done for every Ind AS. There are few exemptions given under Ind AS 101, which is a transition standard, which will be taken up subsequently in the slides. And second important thing which we need to know is we have been always seeing balance sheet, the financial statement as balance sheet, the statement of profit and loss and cash flow. Same thing continues in Ind AS. We have balance sheet, we have statement of profit and loss. Something more here is under statement of profit and loss, we have two components, statement of P&L and statement of other comprehensive income, which is known as OCI. Under other comprehensive income, again, we have two breaks. One, those incomes or expenditure which can never come back to the reserves, those which can come back to the reserves, means to say, those profits which can be taken over by the company and those which can never be taken over by the company. Simple example, actuarial gains or losses. Any movements in actual gains or losses for employee benefits can never come back to company. It is the income or the asset or the liability of employees. So that will never come back to P&L. We show it under OCI itself. In addition to this, we have statement of changes in equity, which is known as SOC. Whatever we used to show under share capital before will come under statement of changes in equity. Under statement of changes in equity, we will show the share capital, the reserves and surplus, and also the statement of other comprehensive income. Entire amounts which are part of equity. Equity is the residual thing, whatever goes to the share cap, equity share capital, that comes under statement of changes in equity. Finally, notes. Notes forms the biggest part of any Ind AS financial statements. That's where as an auditor or as a finance personnel, everyone spends a lot of time on the notes. the details what we disclose there gets published, and the assumptions what we make also gets published. We have to spend good amount of time to understand what sort of assumptions has to be done vis-a-vis various Indian accounting standards, and then only the disclosure has to happen. The background material for Ind AS is our Ind AS document, plus there is IFRS, the standards which are issued by international board, the IFRS is there, plus IFRIC, which are basically the analysis part which is happening in IFRS, that will be there. In Ind AS, we do not have separate for analysis and the standards. Both are combined together. IFRS and IFRIC are combined together, and it has become Ind AS. It is part of Ind AS. Others, when it comes to Ind AS, something which we need to know, there is no way we can give a complete picture of Ind AS. We have to always round off the numbers. Minimum round off has to be 200, which is mandatory under Ind AS. Then the statement has to be made saying this is compliant with Ind AS, that is also mandatory. Our Companies Act has issued Schedule 3, which needs to be complied, which needs to be taken, which needs to be signed by the auditors and the companies. Specific format is there. All the old formats used to have equity and share capital first. In Schedule 3 for Ind AS, assets come first, and later on comes our equity and liabilities, one of the changes. Date of transition, as I said, very important. Date of transition has a direct impact on income taxes. Under income taxes for Section 115 JB, date of transition matters a lot. The adjustments what we make on statement of other comprehensive income or reserves and surplus will have a direct impact on 115 JB. There are few exemptions given under 115 JB. Otherwise, every adjustment gets taxed. So date of transition is very important over there. Analysis in brief, as I said, the moment Ind AS is applicable for any of the group entities, their associate or their subsidiary or their parent becomes liable for Ind AS. Let us try to understand how it works. In the given example, A Private Limited is one of the shareholders. Let us call him as a parent for S Private Limited. B Limited is another entity which is again holding shares in S Private Limited. Let us presume A holds 51% and B holds 49% in S Private Limited. As I mentioned, B is a listed company and they are liable for Ind AS. They are following Ind AS. Now, because B is following Ind AS as they are a listed company, S will be forced to follow Ind AS. They are liable to comply with Ind AS as they are the subsidiary of B. Should A follow Ind AS is one of the issue, one of the concerns. Going by law, A need not to follow Ind AS because the wordings which are used in Ind AS is the company which is an associate or a subsidiary or a holding company of an entity which is liable for Ind AS. Means to say A Private Limited to comply with Ind AS, S Private Limited should have had at least 250 crore of net worth. S do not have 250 crore of net worth. S is doing Ind AS because of B. So S is indirectly liable to comply with Ind AS. Since S is not directly liable, A need not to comply with Ind AS. Just because a holding or subsidiary of an entity which is liable for Ind AS doesn't mean that you have to comply with Ind AS. You need to understand under which provision you fall under. A has an option to choose Ind AS. Once chosen, they have to follow Ind AS forever. Otherwise, they can opt to comply, continue with ICAP. First time adoptions, couple of things which we need to keep in mind. The objective should not be to give as much or take as much of exemptions as possible. Any company should focus on identifying the various impacts, and they need to, if objective is to keep differences as minimal as possible between Ind AS and IGAAP, the whole transition will be stronger, whole transition will be more beneficial for the stakeholders. Whenever Ind AS transition is done, give more importance for the significant transactions which has happened in the company in the previous years. When we say significant transaction, if it is a manufacturing company, there will be inventory valuation, there will be fixed asset valuation, fixed asset capitalization, there will be inventory write down or write up, there will be valuation of investments, valuation of analysis of subsidiaries, all those stuff will come. Need to understand what transactions have happened in the past year. Accordingly, you plan your Ind AS transition, go line by line, understand what are the standards, principles given under the standards, and what exemptions and exceptions are available under Ind AS 101. And the most beneficial can be taken up. Whenever transition is done, you have to also look at the various angles. Just because of transition, if you complete your transition process and make the balance sheet, there could be bigger impacts from other sides. Imagine a case where you are a company which is doing cost plus, you are under liable under transfer pricing mechanism. All your costs plus some percentage will be your turnover. You had to continue, you had to transit into Ind AS and you had lease. When you make transition to Ind AS and when you had lease, you have to accrue right to right of asset. You will account right of asset, which is IFR, which is Ind AS 116. The biggest difference between IGAAP and Ind AS under leases is, in IGAAP we used to account rental as rental and debit to P&L. When it comes to Ind AS, we have to identify the future rents what we pay to any commercial, any property which we have, and discount it as of today's rate, which is the incremental borrowing rate. We end up with a good amount of asset in our books. On those assets, we accrue depreciation and we account interest. The way numbers fluctuate on your P&L has a direct impact on transfer pricing. The way numbers fluctuate, it was rental expenditure before, now it will become depreciation and interest. The moment there is a change, your 105 JV will have an impact, your transfer pricing will have an impact. You have to be careful and do necessary documentation across all the transactions. Imagine there was rental expenditure before, now there is no rental expenditure. How do you deal with GST audits? How do you deal with GST reconciliations? You have an input on rentals, but you are not able to disclose that in your P&L. It will be appearing as depreciation and interest. Per se, there is no GST credit on depreciation and interest. These reconciliations matter a lot for any Ind AS companies. Then another important thing, you will have to update your books of accounts, chart of accounts, you will have to update your reports, you will have to update the way consolidation has been done in the organization. Ind AS 115 requests you to change the way you are recording revenue. Ind AS 116 will change the way you are recording rentals. Ind AS 119 will change the way you are recording your employee benefits. The borrowing cost changes completely. Ind AS 109 makes you to relook into all the financial instruments and see what is the fair valuation which needs to be done. So this can be possible only when you change the chart of accounts, the whole records and books which you maintain in the organization. So transition date, I explained. Reconciliation statements. This is again an important disclosure which the first time adopter has to give. Date of transition is the date in which you have moved to Ind AS. On that date, you will make a balance sheet where you disclose how the numbers changed. What was the net worth before? What is the net worth because of Ind AS? What was the revenue before? What is the revenue because of Ind AS? What was the reserves and surplus before? And what is the current reserves and surplus? Line by line, for every variance, for every difference, we'll have to give reconciliation statements. That is a major disclosure in the first year of adoption. General impact, because of Ind AS, investment value will change. Previously, under accounting standard, we used to disclose at cost. But in Ind AS, we'll have to see whether it is fair value through OCA or fair value through P&L. That changes your net worth and the investment value. Whenever you have contingent consideration, whenever you acquire a company or an asset, and you have a contingent consideration, rather, contingent consideration can be of two things. based on the turnover or based on certain activities which is going to happen in future. If it is a retention money, if we have to pay after 5 years, under IGAAP we should just show that as liability. But under Ind AS, we'll have to discount it to current value. If we need to pay X amount after 5 years, you have to discount it to today's value, account in the books accordingly, and then keep on increasing that value to amount. It is basically called as amortized cost. It will be increased to realizable value. Every year we keep on accruing interest. This was not done in IGAAP. In Ind AS, it has to be done. It has a direct impact on net worth. Actuarial adjustments, entire actual gain or losses of employee benefits, we used to show under employee benefit cost under Schedule 3. Now it has to be broken under two different statements. One portion goes into statement of profit and loss, and the actuarial gain or losses comes to statement of other comprehensive income. The way your earnings per share is computed, the way your income taxes are computed changes a lot. Deferred taxes, again, under IGAAP, we had an option to go with either P&L approach or balance sheet approach, but in Ind AS, it is only balance sheet. And in IGAAP, there were not much, rather when a company has carry forward of losses, you are not allowed to create deferred tax asset on the losses and depreciation. But in Ind AS, it is beyond that, it says you can claim it. So your deferred tax asset will increase, which has a direct impact on the net worth. ECL is known as expected credit loss. We used to have something called bad debts under IGAAP. In Ind AS, it is called expected credit loss. Bad debts means once transaction happens, we accrue bad debts. But in expected credit loss, we project what could be the bad debts which may happen in future. Project it now based on your past experience and make a provision. Expected credit loss will be made. Imagine a case where there is a level recognized in the current year, immediately we'll go and accrue for expected credit loss, which was never a scenario in IGAAP. We used to wait until many of the customers go bad, and then we used to accrue the liability, or rather we used to reduce the asset portion. In Ind AS, we accrue it immediately. Let us take few standards and understand what are the basic practical issues which we may face either in audits or in while preparing the books. Inventories is one of the biggest asset in any balance sheet for manufacturing companies. How inventories change in Ind AS principle? As you all know, when we compute inventory, we take up the cost of materials and cost of conversions. Cost of conversion will include the employee cost, it will include the depreciation portion, it will include interest portion. Whatever we used to do under IGAAP continues to be done in Ind AS, no major changes. Primary packing and secondary packing is something which we need to be worried in Ind AS. Primary packing becomes part of inventory. Secondary packing is more a part of advertisement cost that goes to P&L. And primary packing will sit in the balance sheet as inventory. Reversal in write down. Whenever NRV of an inventory, net realizable value of an inventory, is below the cost, under Ind AS 2, we need to reduce it to the net NRV. And subsequently, if the demand for the product improves, obviously the net realizable value will grow. Whenever we reverse that, directly we will take it into cost of goods. The production cost, it comes to production cost. Different cost formulae we have, either we can go with first in first out, or we can go with weighted average, that continues to be the same. Something different in Ind AS, the deferred settlement scheme. What happens, we have two, let us take an example, a company has two vendors, vendor A and vendor B. Both of them supply the same product, but vendor A gives a credit period of 120 days and vendor B asks us to pay and take the items. Under IGAAP, for both the transaction, we had no differences. We used to account it as purchase of inventory. But in Ind AS, there is a huge difference. How Ind AS always considers the fair value of a transaction, and it also considers the present value of rupee and the interest portion. When someone is giving you 120 days of credit, basically that 120 days of working capital, you are able to get the benefit. There is a financing arrangement involved in it. Or in Ind AS, we need to identify for every transaction whether there is any financing component. For 120 days, if someone is giving to us, obviously he'll be charging his interest portion. Where if I have to pay in advance, I would have paid 100 rupees. If I have to take it on credit, he might be asking me to pay 110 rupees. That 10 rupees, even though it is there on the purchase invoice, 10 rupees we will push into another line item called financing cost. That goes in statement of P&L under financing cost, and only 100 rupees will come under cost of consumption. This is one of the important differences between IGAAP and Ind AS. Wherever you see there is a credit element involved, you have to go back and make adjustment in your inventory valuation and financing cost. Provision for inventory, IGAAP is...
What is the reasonable period of credit? 120 days would be normal. I thought it's more than 180 or 270 days. That would
be based on your methodology, there could be cases where credit can be 6 months, credit can be 9 months. I just took an example. Here it is to understand whether there is any credit and whether it is on advance and what is the difference between those two. If it is on advance, there is no financing element. If it is on credit, there is a financing element. Again, it is assumption. You have to give your assumptions as to on what basis you have identified the financing cost. Yes, Ind AS 2 will come with lots of disclosures. Every company should give the disclosures. Provision for inventory, it is not directly mentioned in Ind AS 2. It is part of Ind AS 37, which is provisions. Under IGAAP, we never had this direct provision. What companies does is, you would have seen many multinational companies who have subsidiaries in India. They have a concept wherein if an inventory is slow moving or non moving, they create provision. There was an argument in IGAAP, is provision allowed under IGAAP? Because AS2 tells cost or NRV, whichever is lower. There could be a possibility the NRV is still more than cost, but the selling price would have got impaired. For that, we make a provision. It's called provision for impairment of inventory, which is part of Ind AS 37. Based on the age factor, if some inventory is lying in our factory for more than 1 year or more than 2 years, based on this timeline, we make provision in the books, and this gets adjusted in my cost of consumption. Keep in mind, this provision may not be allowable as deduction under income taxes because it is not an actual expenditure. We'll have to add it back there. It has a direct impact on the deferred taxes also. But Ind AS 37, as per the P&L of Ind AS, it will be a debit to P&L. And now, because of COVID and the issues which are happening outside, there are some challenges which will have a direct impact on inventory. One could be, as an auditor has to comment on the key audit matters. So every auditor has to give his views, or he has to identify areas where estimations are involved. Key audit matters are those matters where financial statements will have estimation. When it comes to inventory, one of the biggest estimations is what is the net realizable value of inventory. It is always at the estimation of the company. They estimate, if they estimate the NRV is more than cost, as an auditor, we need to confirm is the NRV is more than cost. If NRV, they have written down below the cost, we need to have documentation for the estimates involved, the assumptions involved, and the workings involved. As an auditor, we have to disclose in our audit report the key audit matter for inventory valuation. That is very important during these days. Companies may not be able to liquidate their inventories. Inventory would have been piling up in the organization. Inventory would have been aged in the organization. The estimation involved, we have to bring the point in auditor's report. Plus, onerous contracts. Onerous contracts is part of, again, Ind AS 37. Honors contract means we have taken a contract from our customer, selling price is decided, and for that we need to incur cost. We have to manufacture an item, one of the products, we have to manufacture one of the products. The selling price was 1 crore. And initially when we had budgeted, the cost was 80 lakh, we had a 20% of 20 lakh rupees of margin. But because of various things which have happened during COVID lockdown, we might not be able to get the basic raw materials or the basic consumables. This may lead for us to go back and buy from someone where the cost is higher. The cost of procurement may become more than the cost of the selling price, but we cannot cancel the contract. These kind of contracts where the selling price is less than the cost are called onerous contracts. We need to, when closing the balance sheet, we need to see what are all those contracts where costs are more than revenue, and we may have to accrue liability for that, provision for it. It comes under Ind AS 37, and also it will be part of our key audit matter. And this is very important during this COVID period. And again, the COVID impact could be impairment of inventory, which we just discussed. Fixed production overhead, again, we have an impact. Fixed production overhead, no matter whether you have produced or not, no matter whether you have sold or not, fixed production overhead will continue to be there in the organization. Will that change under Ind AS? Fixed production overheads has to be allocated on the normal capacity of any company. Normal capacity was, say, 50 metric tons, but actual capacity would have been 25 metric tons. Here, I cannot change the capacity from 50 to 25. We should go with the 50 metric tons itself, and whatever the excess unutilized production overheads needs to be debited to P&L. Again, this comes with the way explanations and disclosures in the Ind AS balance sheet. Explanation needs to be done as to what extent these unutilized overheads has been debited to P&L. That's an important disclosure. Physical verification, many people are not able to travel. You may have your clients or you may have your branches which is there outside Karnataka or outside the place where you are located. You cannot go and visit them. You need to do certain analysis on your own, get some documentation, get some estimations. You have a challenge over there. Excessive discounts. Inventory would have been piling up in your organization. To sell the materials, you keep on giving discounts. You may increase your discounts. It has a direct impact on your inventory valuation. If discounts are more and if NRV is going to be less than the cost, you have to make impairment. One, that is one thing. And second, when discounts are more, under Ind AS 115, we need to relocate the way transaction can happen. If these kind of discounts leads to any volume discount for our customer, or if any customer is asked for discounts later on, we need to see whether there could be an impact under Ind AS 115. Next important item under Ind AS is property, plant and equipment. Inventory forms one of the biggest line item in any balance sheet, and property, plant and equipment, based on the companies, whether it is an IT entity or it's a manufacturing or it's a service industry, PPE is always there for every companies. And the amendments or the requirements in PPE is quite a lot. We'll have to understand the basic assets which are being used by the company, and various adjustments will have to be done both as preparer of book and auditor of the books. Simple thing which may have any impact is when we are constructing a property, plant and equipment. We might be constructing property, plant and equipment on a leasehold land. The rentals of those leasehold lands, we should make sure it is capitalized. Under IGAAP, we had an option to write off assets which is less than 5,000 rupees. That still continues in Ind AS. You can decide what is that value of asset you want to write off, and what is the value of asset which you want to capitalize. It is allowed under Ind AS. With the proper disclosure, you can still continue doing that. Asset retirement obligation, it's a new concept. which is there in, which has come in IGAAP also. IGAAP 10 got amended for retirement obligation. What exactly is asset retirement obligation? Assume a company is into chemical manufacturing. They have taken an equipment, they have purchased an equipment, and it is installed in a place which is taken on rent. The company has taken on rent for 20 years. Equipment is installed over there. The agreement says after 20 years, you need to bring the land or the place in the way it was given to you. In any time, whenever we make equipments on factory, we spend lot of money on maybe cabling, maybe wiring, there will be civil construction, there will be lighting, so many things will happen. We may have to, the companies may have to alter the physical structure. Under asset retirement obligation, what happens is when we have, after 20 years, when we have to hand it over the asset, we spend good amount of money to bring the asset back to its original condition. When I say asset, the building has to be brought into original condition. For that, we spend money. In IGAAP, we used to account when we incur those expenditure, but in Ind AS, we have to identify after 20 years, how much should we incur, find that value. Say after 20 years, we should incur 1 crore. That 1 crore needs to be brought into present value, which is today. We'll have to bring it down to today's value. That 1 crore may come down to 30 lakh rupees today. Or that is how fixed asset retirement obligation will be identified and brought into present value. That entire amount gets capitalized into fixed assets today, and we start claiming depreciation. That is one. And second, what happens, whatever we have brought into present value, year on year, we keep on increasing, we keep on accruing interest on it. First year it was 30 lakh and our discounting rate is 10%. So we provide 10% interest. We debit interest and we credit provision for retirement obligation. So there I am accounting 10 on 30 lakh, we may account 3 lakh rupees. The debit will go to P&L, credit goes to provision for asset retirement obligation. After 20 years, this 30 lakh will go to 1 crore. We have the liability in the books up to 1 crore and we make the payment of 1 crore rupees, the liability will be made good. The logic here is how this expenditure is not incurred at the end of the period, but that is incurred because of me using that plant for all these years. That way, profits which can be distributed to shareholders, which can be distributed as managerial remuneration, gets restricted and it is being kept aside. And after 20 years, we have enough funds to make the payment. Similar way, we have to take up certain adjustments in PPE, as I said, deferred payments. Again, like how in inventory, we may have deferred payments in property, plant and equipment also. Need to identify how much is interest portion. To that extent, we don't capitalize onto the plant, but we take it into the P&L. Cancellation fee, there could be a cancellation fee wherein I had agreed to buy an asset, but I find some other vendor who can sell the same asset at a better rate, but I end up paying cancellation fees. This cancellation fee has nothing to do with purchase of a new asset. It cannot go to capitalization, but it goes to P&L. Liquidated damages, we might have asked vendor to make good for the damages which he has done while sending the material. Whatever we get, it is not part of the fixed asset, it is again part of P&L. Cost of approval, while constructing plant, we may have to take various approvals. Like in Bangalore, we have to take BBMP approval and all other pollution control departments approval and all. These costs directly pertain to fixed asset, we should capitalize. Take an example of a manufacturing company where they are starting a new plant in one of the rural areas. They have to go and they have to rehabilitate the people over there. They have to construct new houses for them. You may have to construct a new hospital for them. You may have to construct a new school over there. Without doing that, you do not get the permission to construct your plant. All these costs, even though does not add value to your plant, but they are mandatorily to be spent for you to get approval for constructing your building. It is that in that scenario, in that manner, it is part of your direct cost, and you will end up capitalizing these costs even though they are not adding any direct value for your production facility. Similar way, capitalization of depreciation, which is something required to be taken care of. Is there any way depreciation can be capitalized? There are cases if a company is developing any intangible asset, or if a company is developing any other in-house capital asset, wherein you are utilizing certain other capital equipments of your own company, such depreciation, you cannot take it to P&L, but it has to come as cost of development for the new asset. Component accounting is again an important item in our fixed assets, in the property, plant and equipment. We need to break the whole property, plant and equipment into various components and depreciate each component separately. Simple example could be a computer laptop. A computer laptop may have various accessories. It comes with a hard disk, it comes with some keyboard, it comes with a camera, various other things. You need to identify each of those components. Are they material for that asset? And if you feel that is material, you may have to depreciate in a different manner. The computer is one simple thing, but if you see the bigger things, for example, an IT company has to manage the servers. Server comes with various other equipments. There is a main server, there is a computer system, there is some cables, all those things comes at one shot. But each of the component will have different life. Depreciation has to be done separately for each of the component. That is again an important item under Ind AS. Assets held for sale is, in IGAAP, we never had a concept called assets held for sale. Even though once we stop using an asset, we used to just keep it under property, plant and equipment. But in Ind AS, when you decide to sell any asset, you will move that asset from property, plant and equipment. You will push into a separate line item called assets held for sale. And when you push it over there, you will push at net realizable value. This is par, and you will not revalue those assets. You will not depreciate those assets. It will be held separately in the balance sheet. Investment property, like what we had accounting for investments in IGAAP, there is a concept called investment property. What exactly is investment property? Investment property is not a part of Ind AS 16. It's not property, plant and equipment. It's a separate thing. Take example of Prestige. Prestige has commercial complexes which are revenue making, which are revenue earning. These are called investment properties, where you are using to earn revenue. On the other hand, Infosys has huge investment properties, but those investment properties are not per se revenue earning for Infosys. It is used for their administrative purposes, for their operation purposes. So the same asset, under one's book, it becomes investment property, which is under Prestige, but under Infosys, it will become part of property, plant and equipment. Now, what is the difference between a item which is called investment property against an item which is called property, plant and equipment? Investment properties, even though in IFRS, investment properties are on par with property, plant and equipment, in Ind AS, they both are considered in a totally different manner. Property, plant, equipment, we can revalue. Investment properties, you can never revalue. You have to show it at cost, but you will disclose the fair valuation. You have to disclose in the financial statements, notes, what are the fair value of investment properties, how these things are changing. Those disclosures are very important. Just because to show a higher net worth, you cannot devalue investment properties, it is par. It has to be shown only at cost. This is one important concept which we need to be aware. Now, what happens? Because of COVID, there could be some impairment on investment properties. The revenue earning capacity of investment property could have been reduced. Before 31st March, you will have to analyze what is the impact on revenue earning capacity, whether this has to be impaired. If at all it has to be impaired, you have to take the adjustments in the P&L. And as an auditor, you will have to do analysis of the assumptions which has been taken care by the company, and reporting will be done under key audit matter. COVID impact, like under inventory, we'll not be able to do physical verification. We'll not be able to understand the, we'll not be able to estimate the future earning capacity. Lots of assumptions will be involved. Couple of machineries may not be used because of reduced production, reduced demand. Equipment usage could have reduced very much. There is a direct impact on impairment. There is a direct impact on cost of production. Borrowing cost. Take example where a company was manufacturing one, had initiated investment in one of the projects. The project's output was supposed to be exported. Because of restriction on transportation, you are not able to make your exports. Your customer is not ready to take the goods immediately, and you take a decision to delay completing your project. During that period, even though you are incurring interest, you cannot capitalize it. It has to go to P&L. This is very important item, and you will have to disclose in the balance sheet that portion of interest, even though is taken for project, but which is going into P&L. Another impact will be under CARO. There would be a reconciliation requirement under CARO. If something has gone to P&L before your asset, even though asset is not put into use, the question may come from bankers. What is the reason for taking into P&L? Is it like something where funds have been, funds are utilized for any other purposes? So those explanations in India's financial statements will support your argument. Even banks will be comfortable on that. Other standards, Ind AS 37, provisions, contingent liabilities and contingent asset. Why provision is important? Generally, and even under IGAAP, provision was one of the last standards. Here it is again one of the last standards on Ind AS 37. Where if I have to talk from the side of IAS, it is one of the last standards. But in the current scenario, provisions are very important. The balance sheet may have a good quantum of items sitting under provisions. Because of COVID, there could be provisions for inventory. There could be provisions for various penalties and dues. There could be provision under onerous contracts. There could be provisions for buyback of assets. So both as preparers of books and as reviewer of books, we need to see whether the company has made basic provisions in their books. Onerous contracts, I explained, where the cost incurred to get the product is more than the revenue from the product. Such cases, we need to make provision immediately. So make sure in the current year it is there. Option to buy back the asset. I mean, you would have seen many cases where you have the seller will give you an option. He sells you one product and he gives you an option. Within 2 years, you can come back and upgrade the product. Those options have become very much used nowadays. There you have a requirement. You need to analyze for all the products which has been sold during the year, how much percentage of customers can come back to us to buy back, or rather to buy a next version, the additional version. The agreement between buyer and seller will be, seller would have given them an option to buy revised or rather updated product at a discounted rate. We need, as a seller, we need to make provision in our books for that discount today itself. Previously in IGAAP, what we used to do, selling price we used to account in the subsequent year. The cost would have been X, selling price would have been Y. We used to account in the year in which the actual sale happens. But under Ind AS, wherever we have these kind of contracts, we need to make a provision as to what percentage of people will come back to us and what is the discount which we are going to give. That amount needs to be accrued immediately. That is, and also, this is again important because of COVID and because of the economy is not on the par with the earlier year. Companies might have given additional benefits under this. Companies would have, for increasing their product sales, they might be coming out with the new schemes. You have to be aware of the standards, and these provisions need to be created in your books. Restructuring costs, again, due to COVID, many of the companies would have thought, would have decided to restructure the way their organization works, restructure the way their domain works. Wherever they have decided to restructure and the cost budget is already done, you may have to make provisions in the books. Where, and again, the important part here is, just because there is a restructuring idea with the organization, you cannot make the provision. That idea should have been brought into place. Just a board's discussion that we may have to change, we may have to restructure, is not the primary evidence. At that scenario, you will not make the provision. But cases where companies have started their restructuring activity, you will have to create provision. That may include during restructuring, you may pay a good lump sum of money to your employees. You may pay good lump sum of money to your vendors. You may be making payments for your landlords, various people. That portion will come under restructuring cost. Even though amounts are not incurred, you have a plan for it. That will come in your books. That will have a direct impact on the network, on the profit and loss of the company. Insurance claims. Many of the companies will have insurance for loss of business and loss of profits. 2020, 2021, your profits would have got reduced. Your business turnover would have got reduced. Just because you have an insurance, can you go and account it as insurance income in the books? No. You need to account only those cases where the insurer has acknowledged such demand and there is a documentation to substantiate that we have been approved with the insurance. Only those cases we account it as insurance receipts or incomes. Else, we will, just because of premium, we cannot account it. We have to wait until the money comes or the approval comes. Again, you will see a lot of insurance claims in the current year. Expected losses for subsequent financial years. As we are in March, we know what is our total turnover, what is our total profit or losses in the current year. And we, by now, we also know what can happen in 2021 and 2022. Just because 2021-22 has losses, can someone go and accrue for those losses? Because the transaction would have happened now, the expenditure incurred would have been incurred now, certain portion is yet to be incurred in the next year. Can we accrue for the liability? Answer is no. It has to be done only when transaction happens. Provision for corporate social responsibility. 31st March will be the due date for corporate social responsibility. Whether you had profit or not in the current year, if you are liable under Section 135 of Companies Act, you may have to do that. Before 31st March, we need to incur expenditure and spend the money. There is no question of provision for CSR under schedule under Companies Act. If it is actual, it is actual. You will disclose in the balance sheet. If you have not incurred, you will have to disclose your reason for non-incurring, and there could be certain penal provisions under Companies Act. This is more about provisions. Next one is lease. Again, why lease is important? Current year, lease is one of the most amended standard, not only in India, but across the globe. Many of the companies who are either as landlords or as tenants, majority of the people are working from home, majority of the shopping complexes are empty now, majority of the service industry, service areas, maybe your the amusement parks or it could be cinema halls, all those things are empty now. So the users, rather the owners of that and the users, the tenants of those areas would have agreed for some sort of benefits. There could be some compensation or there could be some concession given by the landlord. 2020-21, your financial statements will have these adjustments. You focus on those, see what are all the concessions you have received, and under IFRS 16, which is Ind AS 116, if there are any concessions given by landlord, if you go by IFRS 16, this will be considered as an amendment for the lease document, but there is an exemption given in the current year. Any concession given during 2021, you don't have to go and change the entire lease. You can directly take it into P&L in the current year. Example, we had to pay 1 crore rupees of rent every month. So that would have become 12 crores. For next 5 years, the total amount would have become 100 crores or 120 crores. That 120 crores would have discounted it to today. That value would have come to 70 crores and we would have accounted 70 crores as right to use asset in books. Because in the current year, my landlord said, you don't have to pay rental. The whole workings will change. Current year, rental payment is zero. Subsequent year, only rental payments we take. And we have to re-estimate the right of use asset and the right of use liability. This is as per IFRS 16 or Ind AS 116. This would have given a lot of difficulties for both the users and the preparers of balance sheet. And would have not have given the correct true picture also. The current exemption what they have given is, even though there is a change in your rental terms, you don't have to revise the right of use asset and right of use liability. The differential amount, you accrue the actual expenditure and whatever benefit you have got when you are not making the payment, show it as income in your balance sheet, income in the P&L. So your right to use asset and right of use liability will not change, but P&L gives exact picture. There is a debit of X amount, there is a credit of X amount. In P&L, you do not have it on the profit or loss side. That is one amendment which has been given in leases. Another important thing under leases which was not there in IGAAP.
Liability will come down.
Pardon?
The booking income, yeah. Liability will come down.
Yes, liability comes down. I am not making the payment, right? Yes, both right to use asset and right to use liability will come down. Initial direct cost is an important concept. Say we are taking a land and premises on rent, we are making a payment of commission. Commission could be 2%, 3% on the amount. In IGAAP, that entire amount we used to take it to P&L the year in which it is incurred. In Ind AS, it is called initial direct cost. In Ind AS, what we do is we identify those amounts and we amortize over the life of lease, which was not available in IGAAP. You will have to look into those. COVID impacts, again, in lease, we have there will be something called variable lease. Variable lease is basically for the quantum of asset which is being used. Variable lease will change drastically in the current year. Usage could be reduced. Give importance for it. Another important thing, impairment of right to use. In the previous example, I said 70 crore could be the right to use asset in our books. Is that 70 crore really worth 70 crores? As of March today, we know what is the usage which we are doing. The recoverable amount of that right to use asset would have got impaired. That 70 crore would have come down to 50 crores. Identify that and make the impairment provision. Grant accounting, again, there are a few places where government may be giving some benefit. If you are not able to make the payment of rent, government may bear the rent. So that grant accounting needs to be done. There will be a grant accounting. The income will be accounted in the P&L. Give importance for those. Revenue, which made a lot of noise in the first year when it was made applicable. Entire revenue concept got changed. Previously, there were two standards which got merged into one, IFRS 15, which is Ind AS 115. They brought in five steps to compute revenue. Five steps were basically, they said, identify the contract, understand the various components of the contract, compute the transaction price, allocate the transaction price for each of the components, then account the revenue. So these, we have learned a lot. Last whole year, we spent a lot of time on IFRS 15, which is Ind AS 115. In the current year, the challenges are something beyond that. Current year challenges could be, are we able to collect the money from the customer? Are we able to make the turnover with the prescribed provision, with the prescribed orders? Maybe for one customer, we might have told we'll give 5% discount, and to make that, he may not be coming to us, so for that we have to give more discount. The moment we decide to give more discount, the entire IFRS 15 working, the India's 115 workings will change. There could be multiple elements. We may have to give more credit period. You may have to agree for different currency transactions. All these things will affect the way revenue has been recognized. Give more importance for it. See for the financing component, where you are given credit limit. It is not that whatever customer is paying to you is not only for revenue from operations. There could be a financing element also. Break down the accounting treatment, break down the accounting entry. If you have sold an item for 1 crore, there could be a 5 lakh rupees of financing element. 5 lakh comes to interest income, 95 lakh goes to revenue from operations. Again, you have an issue. Under GST, you should have reconciliations. Under income taxes, even though it is other income, it is not income from other sources in income taxes, it still goes to your business income. Those reconciliations are very much important. Please note, under Ind AS, rather under ITR, if you are following Ind AS, it's a separate disclosure is required under ITR. Concentrate on those. All these items needs to be properly disclosed there, so that your ITR will be processed without much of the issues. Warranty accounting. In warranty accounting, again, from 5 steps, if we are giving warranty to our customers, which means to say, I will take care of this item which I have sold to you for next couple of years. When I collect money from him, I'm collecting not only for the product, I'm also collecting for the warranty which I am selling to my customer. We need to identify how much is towards warranty and how much is towards product. IFRS and Ind AS tells if warranty is required under any statute, then find out the warranty portion and don't accrue that revenue immediately. You need to account it on a belated basis. Means you need to hold that revenue and accrue it over the period of warranty. If warranty is for 2 years, and if the selling price is, say, again 50 lakh rupees, which includes 8 lakh rupees of warranty, that 8 lakhs will not accrue it today. We'll accrue it over a period of next 2 years. On the other hand, take a case where warranty is not required under statute, but company has its own principle. There is a different methodology. You can still go ahead and accrue the amount immediately. You don't have to follow the principles. But on the other hand, under Ind AS 37, the provision for warranty we need to create in the books. We create liability in the books, in the year in which we make the sale. Subsequently, we keep adjusting warranty from the actual warranties. Rentals, a landlord who lets out the land, there will be an escalation principle. What previously they used to do is they used to account it as and when the money is received, but under Ind AS, if I am the landlord who has let out land and building, if there is an escalation, like how we used to do under AS 19 in the books of lessee, we used to straight line the expenditure. Similar way, in the books of lessor, in the books of landlord, we identify what is the total inflow of rental divided by number of period for which I have let it out, and that is called the average amount, and that amount will be credited to my P&L. So if you see across, my P&L will show the same amount for all the years. There is no variance year on year just because of escalation. This is an amendment. This is a difference in Ind AS and IGAAP. Coming to consolidation, the issue in revenue, you may all know under IGAAP joint venture, we used to add the revenue and expenditure of joint venture as a separate line item. But under Ind AS, for joint venture accounting, we follow equity method. The moment we follow equity method, we are not taking revenues of joint ventures in consolidated financial statement. So the revenue in consolidated financial statement may drastically reduce. That is one thing which we need to know. Coming to key audit matter, you take any key audit matter out of 100 companies, we can blindly tell at least 95 companies will have a key audit matter on revenue. The way revenue has to be accounted now with IFRS 15, too many complications are, too many adjustments are there, too many estimations will be there. So auditor does a lot of work to confirm revenue has been accounted completely and there are no material misstatements. The assertions needs to be complete. As an auditor, we check on various assertions. It could be about completeness, it could be about cutoff, it could be about accuracy, it could be about valuation. All these items needs to be reviewed by the auditor, and revenue is one of the major items in key audit matter. Then provision for returns, again a part of key audit matter. How much returns may happen, that has to be computed under IFRS Ind AS 115. How much ever returns are computed, it is based again based on estimation. Under Ind AS 115, total revenue will be revenue minus provision for returns, so it is net of returns. How did you arrive at that net of returns? As an auditor, auditor spends a time on that, and it will be his key audit matter in the audit report. Accounting for discount is also similar. The COVID impact which could be there on Ind AS 115. One, year is over, sales are done, but there could be a possibility that my customers may return the materials. As on 31st March, you would have shown good amount of sales. Post 31st March, there could be returns. Please have a look into those. And even though in earlier years, returns were less, we cannot presume the same continues because of all the restrictions, because of business impact on the business, there could be returns. You will have to make adjustments or you will have to make provisions for it. Volume discount, again, to improve your turnover, you might be giving more volume, more discounts. Volume may not increase, but still you may have to give discounts. This has to be taken care in the balance sheet. Unbilled revenue, there could be a lot of unbilled revenues in the books for various reasons, but you have to have the estimate, you have to have documentation to substantiate how is it an unbilled revenue and why is it, why it should not be taken in the P&L. There has to be a confirmation from the customer. There has to be compliance with all the requirements of the purchase order or a sales order. Assertions needs to be complied, then only it can come in the P&L. Disclosure part, very important in the current year. Your disclosure should have a detailed note on uncertainty of cash flows. Nobody knows how could our cash flow may be in April or May or June. A detailed analysis of cash flow needs to be done in financial statements 2020-21. Deterioration in the credit worthiness. We would have made sales to our customers. Credit rating would have been fantastic in the earlier year. Current year, their credit rate would have gone down. That disclosure, that impact on the balance sheet would be pretty high. It has a direct impact on expected credit losses. It has a direct impact on the risk factor of a company. Disclosure comes. You may have to increase the credit limit for your customers. You would have agreed for 60. The client may start explaining the difficulties which he is facing. You may have to extend it to 120. You may have to extend it to 180. Again, those matters will be there for both the book preparer and the reviewer. One of the general things which may happen, you are making a customer required product which has been given by customer, rather the mold which has been given by the customer or the design which has been given by the customer. You have manufactured that product for customer, but unfortunately as on balance sheet date, that is not being picked up by your customer. You cannot take it as directly as a revenue. You have to get into the transactions and see whether risk and rewards are transferred or not. Even though it is made for customer, there could be a possibility you still hold the risk and rewards. Give more importance for this and look into the revenue recognition principle. Yes.
Here they say the control has not been handed over to customer. Even if the agreement says that the ownership is transferred, because the customer cannot enjoy the goods, you cannot recognize the sale.
See what happens. There are two things. Vendor, rather the manufacturer may say, my job is to manufacture this. I will hold this product on behalf of you in my premises. I may pay insurance on behalf of you, but if something goes wrong, you will have to bear the loss. Whether he physically enjoys the benefit or not, if risk and rewards are transferred, it can be considered as your income. But of course, it has to be read, or rather, you have to analyze everything together. The whole objective behind the transaction needs to be seen, and decision has to be taken. Coming to the next one, Ind AS 19, employee benefits. The biggest change will be actual gain or losses. There is a continuously, the interest rates have been reduced during 2020-21. There will be a huge jump movements in actual gain or losses because of discount factor. Second thing, because of employees' termination. There could be cases where employees could have been terminated, employees could have been asked to leave. A good impact would be there on the P&L because of change in the assumptions. You might have assumed few people to continue for so many years, but they leave, there is the actual gain or loss. That is another impact you have to consider. PF, last year there was one announcement made by government for a specified employers. Employer PF was borne by company, by governments. In the current year, we need to see whether there will be any similar propositions given by the government. If there are certain grants which are given for this, you might have to account it as income, and similarly, there will be an expenditure in the books. In your P&L, there will be no impact, but you'll be showing it as government grants. Again, you have to comply with those. Share-based accruals, again, all the startups or majority of the companies, which are MNCs, where they give a lot of share-based incentives. There could be changes in the way your share, the values have been changing. There could be changes in the way valuation has been done. There could be changes in vesting methodologies. Have a look at it. What changes would have happened in the agreed terms needs to be brought down into the P&L. There could either be additional provision, or there could be reversal of provisions, direct impact on the P&L and the reserves part. ESOPs from parent, IGAAP did not give any specific accounting treatment if ESOPs are given by parent, but in Ind AS, there is a specific treatment. Means, parent is in US, subsidiary is in Bangalore. The subsidiary company's employees are eligible for ESOPs of US company. And US company does not charge any expenses onto Indian company. In IGAAP, the companies never used to account for it. What used to happen, if someone gets ESOP, the parent company used to pay the employee directly, employees to get in their bank account after deduction of taxes. In India, what happens, the standard says, parent company is making payment to subsidiary company for the services given by the employees of subsidiary company. So parent is bearing the cost. What happens in Indian company is Indian company was just acting as a funding agent between parent and employees. In India, what we do now, that whatever ESOP which has been given by parent, we will show it as investment made by parent. We will show it as part of equity, and against that we accrue expenditure in our books. It is employee benefit, I will debit employee benefit expenditure, which is ESOP expenditure. And if it was my stock, I would have created reserves in my books. Instead of that, since here the ESOP belongs to my parent, I will credit into equity. Under equity, we have so many things. It comes under statement of changes in equity. What happens in parent book? They will show it as investment in subsidiary, and there will be a corresponding adjustments when you do consolidation. There is an investment in one entity, there is an equity in the other entity. So now the books match. Financial instruments, few things which needs to be taken care in Ind AS. If there is a loan or borrowing in our books, in Ind AS, there will be a lot of changes compared with IGAAP. Take an example, we borrow loan. Whenever we borrow loan, we make processing fees. We pay processing charges to bankers. In IGAAP, that entire processing charges of 1% or 0.5%, whatever amount we pay, used to get debited to P&L. But in Ind AS, that whole amount, whatever we are paying as processing charges, needs to be amortized over the life of loan. So exactly what happens is, say a loan has been taken for 9.2% and processing charge of 0.5%. The loan is for 20 crores. On 20 crores, there is X amount of processing charge and Y amount of interest. What we do in Ind AS is, we take the whole processing charge, we add up into interest, and that interest will be allocated over the period of loan. The effective interest rate will not only be 9.2%, it will be 9.2% plus processing charge. It may go up to 9.5%. That 0.3% difference is because of amortization of processing charge over the period. This one is important. In current year, what may happen? Many of the companies may have loan in foreign currency, LIBOR plus X percent, LIBOR plus Y percent. LIBOR keeps on, has changed a lot in the current year. This will result in huge fluctuation on the amounts which has to be capitalized or which has to go into P&L. The fluctuation needs to be explained appropriately in the balance sheet, and recomputation of effective interest rate has to be done by the company. Guarantee accounting is again a concept which has come in Ind AS, which was not there in IGAAP. Similar to the ESOP accounting, parent company may have given guarantee on behalf of my Bangalore entity for one of my bankers. As such, Bangalore entity doesn't pay any amount to parent. But if I had to take the loan without guarantee, then obviously interest rate would have been more for this Bengaluru entity. So what Ind AS tells is, identify what would have been the guarantee cost. It would be 0.5% of the loan. That 0.5%, we account in the subsidiary's books as expenditure and we give credit to equity. Similar way, in the books of parent, they will show it as investment in subsidiary. So this is very important item which was not there in IGAAP. Again, this may have an impact in ITR. You have to be careful when you make your IT returns. Expected credit loss, as I explained before, it is nothing but the bad debts. We have to identify what sort of customers we have, how many of them will go bad, how many of them will give after a longer period. Each of those class of debtors, we need to put into different buckets and identify what is the net bad debts which may happen. Say we have 30 crore rupees of debtors, out of that 50 lakh rupees may go bad and 28 crore rupees may be paid to us only after 270 days. So we do this weighted average and we compute one percentage. That percentage may come to say 2.5%. The 2.5% is the expected credit loss percentage. That amount we accrue on the revenue which is done in the current year. In IGAAP, bad debts was accounted only after bad debts, but in Ind AS we do it immediately. Now it is very important because with lots of difficulties in the business, many people may have difficulties to repay the to pay the vendors. Expected credit loss needs to be properly analyzed and auditor has to give a comment on that in the key audit matter. Then security deposit is another concept in Ind AS. Again, coming to rental, whenever we go for rented premises, we will give some amount as security deposit, which is generally interest free. Under fair valuation, we need to identify what is the exact amount of the security deposit which we have given. Take two examples. I have I am a person who wants asset on lease. I go to two vendors. One vendor tells your rental will be 1 crore rupees per month, but deposit will be 10 crore. The other vendor tells rental will be 75 lakh rupees per month, but you have to give a deposit of 15 crore. So both are for the similar asset. What changes here is the deposit amount. One place where if I pay more deposit, my rental will come down. If I pay less deposit, my rental will go up. So what exactly is changing here is the interest factor. We need to identify that for security deposit, say if I'm giving 10 crore rupees of security deposit today, it may be payable back to me after 3 years. After 3 years, what I get is only 10 crore. So what exactly is the deposit which I have given today? To get 10 crore rupees after 3, I may have to deposit 8 crore rupees in FD today, that will go up to 10 crore. So the present value of 10 crore will be 8 crore rupees. In my books, I will account 8 crore rupees as deposit and balance 2 crore. What exactly is that? That interest which I have lost. That interest, whatever I have lost, is nothing but the income for the landlord, and it is in the nature of rentals. So we show it as advance rentals. That's the way security deposit has to be broken. It's one of the important financial instrument. Break the security deposit into security deposit per se and rental advance. Impairment and going concern. There could be a lot of adjustments in the current year. Companies may have to relook what are the assets they have, what sort of impairment which has happened, whether it is going to affect their going concern, whether their future cash flows are affected. All this analysis needs to be done by the company, and auditor will have to consider that while preparing this financial statement. If at all there is any impact on going concern, we have a separate standards on auditing wherein we need to disclose the impact in the audit report. Rather, we need to mention about going concern in the audit report. If going concern is not affected, but there is an impact on COVID, you have an option to show it under emphasis of matter. Goodwill impairment, you have to relook into goodwill impairment. One more thing, goodwill, if it is a purchase goodwill under income tax, then the finance bill said there is no depreciation on goodwill. So you have to be careful if you have created any deferred tax asset on goodwill. If goodwill is not available for depreciation, the deferred tax asset which is created on goodwill needs to be reversed in the current year. Give importance for those. Breach of loan covenants. We have borrowed loan, we are not able to repay it. There is a breach in the covenant. What is the impact of the same? Needs to be brought in the books, needs to be commented in the audit report. Others, miscellaneous things. One, investments. The impact of investment, fair valuation is changing, market value is changing. There could be an impact either on the OCI or on the P&L. Similar way, an auditor will give a comment of the same in the key audit matter. Business combination, would have done business combination before, would have created goodwill in the books. You may have to see whether goodwill needs to be impaired. Reconciliation of income tax, fluctuations are happening every year under Ind AS. We need to give reconciliation for income taxes. What was the book profit? What is the taxes profit as per income taxes? That reconciliation needs to be given in the books. It's a detailed statement. Line by line explanation will be given. What are the cases where income taxes are paid, and what are the cases where taxes are unpaid? And those differences needs to be explained in detail in Ind AS. Again, you will see, in pharma companies, many companies would have started working on vaccine generation. Whether that needs to be capitalized or it has to go to P&L, it's again another decision which a company has to take. In simple, pharma company, until and unless they get the approval from the authorities, no matter how much ever amounts you have spent on developing that vaccine, you cannot capitalize. You should debit it to P&L. Generally, what happens in pharma industries, approval comes only after human trial. And human trial is one of the last segments in any vaccine development. So every expenditure will go to P&L. all pharma companies may have a big hit on the P&L in the current year. Just because they are developing vaccine, it cannot go to intangible assets as assets. That is one thing. Post balance sheet events, please look on the post balance sheet events. Identify all the events which has happened in the market, in the industry, or with the vendors is very important. Vendors and customers. How, what is happening to your vendors? What is happening to your customers? Have a look at those. Your Ind AS balance sheet will have an impact on that. Reconciliations, as I said, every line item where you are given Ind AS adjustments, Ind AS adjustment on leases, Ind AS adjustment on revenue, Ind AS adjustment on employee benefits, everything will have an impact on the P&L. The expenditure which is accounted in the books will be different from the expenditure which is considered in GST returns for input. There will be differences. You need to have reconciliation. Similar way in ITR, we'll have differences. What we show as gratuity in balance sheet will be different from what gratuity comes in the P&L. Gratuity will be broken into statement of P&L and statement of OCI. So when computing income taxes, we compute from the P&L. That portion which goes to OCI is actually not considered in computation. When you do your section 43B under the Income Tax Act, we have a concept of reconciling the closing balance as per 43B with the books of account. If you actually go back and see there, there will always be a difference because of OCI. Please make sure that difference is reconciled. Otherwise, it will have a permanent impact on your balance sheets. Another 43B could be again interest. We may show lease expenditure as an interest in P&L. And if you read 43B per se, interest expenditure, if I am paying any interest to NBFC or bankers, and we need to disallow. So the one way of analyzing which an auditor does is whatever is debited in P&L as interest, has it come in 43B? Again, you will have a difference here, which will not come in 43B, even though it is part of interest, reconciliation should be there. COVID impact, major issues. Your internal financial controls would have got affected because people are working from home. There is disruptions on various business activities. People are working from different places. The control system might not be as it was before when it was work from office. Both for directors and for auditors who has to comment on internal financial control, they need to be a little more clearer. They need to, that their testing methodology should change. They may have to do little more sampling as given under guidance note. Working capital issues, definitely working capital issues will be there. The adjustments which is made because of working capital issues needs to be reviewed by the auditor. So this is all about the session. Thanks a lot. Thanks for giving me an opportunity. And hopefully people would have got some idea about the Ind AS. Thanks to the Institute and thanks to everyone who have been there with us for this last 2 hours.
Thanks, we had an excellent session on updation on Ind AS and latest changes. It had a very detailed presentation on that. Hope all of you enjoyed the learning. Hence, my humble request, whenever we conduct a physical program or virtual program, please register for that and enjoy the benefit of learning. So, as I already mentioned, this study certainly meet to be an opening for the members and students, it is free. I request that make your students also register and learn this from the sessions that will help them in their exams and also in our office work. So please make sure about this. We are circulating, we are sending mail, we are circulating through our WhatsApp group, plus sending mails and SMS on regular basis. So it is our humble request to make use of all these programs and enrich your knowledge. That is the best investment you can do for yourself and your staff or students. With that note, let us once again thank each one of you for participating in this program. As a token of appreciation and gratitude, let us present a commercial to the speaker.
Thanks again, Nathan.
Thank you. Let us stand up for national anthem.
Thank you.